Aloha and good afternoon. I hope that you are still enjoying the conference and still working really hard. I'd just like to do a couple of housekeeping before we start with the last keynote for this year's conference. Tonight we will have a very special event celebrating the 50th anniversary of the conference, and that would be starting sharp at 6 p.m. in this very room. Then that would last for about 35 or 40 minutes or so. Then we will have the traditional luau banquet and show just outside at the promenade area. So we would like very much to have your presence here at the celebration of the 50th event. And in order to encourage you to be here on time, for those who come here before 6 o'clock, they will get a special made Hawaii cookie box for the conference. Thank you. As we are thinking about, as today is the last day of the conference, we would like also to encourage you to think about next year's conference that would be held in this hotel as well. And I would like to encourage you to go to our website in order to look at the deadlines for the call for participation in different forms, symposium, tutorial, workshop, mini track, and anything else that you would like us to do in order to promote science in the field of computer science and management information systems. So with no further ado, I would like to invite my longtime friend, Professor Eric Clements from the Wharton School to be the introducer of the keynote today. Just about Eric came to HICSS for the first time in 1987, and after doing some data analytics for the last 50 years of 19,000 papers published at HICSS, he is ranked number 6 among the top prolific authors at HICSS. So please join me to welcome Eric Clements.
Thank you very much. I think I'm more nervous about introducing John Seely Brown than I would be about giving a keynote. Introducing John Seely Brown at HICSS is like a little kid interrupting his dad saying grace at Thanksgiving to introduce his dad to the family. And everyone else in the room just wants the little kid to sit down and let the grown-ups get on with the celebration. So I'm thinking this should be a song we play. When we introduce the President of the United States, we don't read his bio offline. You know, we just say, the President of the United States, and we play Hail to the Chief. I would like to play the John Seely Brown song and sit down. So everything JSB has ever done is larger than life. As a teenager, he was arrested for drag racing on a public street, and he interrupted the court proceedings to correct the judge. The judge said he was arrested for competing in a competition in speed. JSB pointed out he was competing in a competition in acceleration. And to translate that, JSB already knew he was faster than everyone else. He was just proving he could get faster sooner than everyone else. Okay, so what else do I want to say? JSB is fascinated by understanding and mastering complexity of any kind, but especially interactions among technology and organizations. Today he's going to tell us how we as a community must change how we view the interactions among the technologies we create and the organizations and the entire societies in which we and they are embedded. Okay, that sounds really impressive. Nothing about JSB should surprise you. He was the tallest man ever to ride the winning horse in the Kentucky Derby. He was the shortest man ever to play starting center for the Golden State Warriors. He was the only man to play goalie for the San Jose Sharks, blindfolded. The Dos Equis most interesting man in the world has a tattoo that says simply JSB. I'm going to sit down now and let the grown-ups get on with the show.
Fantastic. Should we start the interview now? Thank you. Hey, these are great notes. Oops, this is the wrong talk. Just a second. There, okay. Eric, thank you for that kind introduction. The game is changing. The real question is, what are the new mindsets? What are the new lenses that may be required to make any sense out of what we're walking into? This is not a political question. This is a social technical question. But first, let's get grounded. Let's back up a moment and look, if you wish, at our past context. You heard about the logistics curve. I call it the sigmoid curve, whatever you want to do. But it is the fact of the 20th century. I'm going to call it a century dominated by a push economy, which almost all of our organizational and strategic architectures are based on things we could do with the infrastructures that we really had. Around the whole notion of scalable efficiency. We could predict, build huge numbers of things, put them in warehouses, then distribute them efficiently. The holy grail simply was scalable efficiency. We have a lot of fancy names for that, but it all comes down to how do you really leverage scalable efficiency? And that requires predictability. It requires hierarchy. It requires understanding organizational routines. And all driven toward the general question of how do you minimize variance. And there's at least of a third of us in this room right now that can lecture a huge amount on how do you actually do that. But then the big shift happened, and all of our keynote speakers have talked about this. How do we move from a curve which basically maybe moves up briefly, but for 20 to 40 to 50 to 60 years, stabilizes out, versus a world like this, in which we have exponential change with no particular sight in scene. But actually, more realistically and more interesting to most of us here, is this exponential curve is really a composition of very fast punctuated evolutions, the average of about 16 to 18 months per blip. And so the exponential curve only looks smooth. It is bang, 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 bang at a fast and furious pace. That does suggest that yesterday's best practices are rapidly becoming outmoded. By the way, that could be even 2 years ago our best practices are becoming outmoded, let alone 20 years ago. Perhaps more interesting to many of us here is our institutional architectures and even our ways of knowing are becoming outmoded. And we may have to invent brand new ways to do this. And I'm really struck by Kevin Kelly's wonderful little book called Inevitable. The cycle of obsolescence is accelerating. The average lifespan of a phone app is more than 30 days. You won't have time to master anything before it is displaced. And my little friend at the bottom says, you know, John, you really call this progress? Maybe not. But somehow we have to think about this in maybe new ways. So let me zoom out for a moment and look at this thing slightly more broadly. I want to look at this issue through three different lenses. I want to look at it through an operations lens, which a third of this room understands a great deal about. Then I'm going to look at it through an epistemological lens, and then I'm going to look at it through an ontological lens. And the answer really comes from the composite of knowing how to look at this through both all three of these lenses. So let's start back down this crazy path. First, through the operational lens. I think it can be best characterized by looking at three quite different eras and what is required in terms of learning strategies, ways of leading, and so on and so forth. When I started to grow up, some questions if I have, but my grandfather and my father said, you know, John, the way to approach this game is think of yourself as driving a steamship. Grit, set a course, and just simply plow on and plow through whatever there is. That was the survival strategy. That was the strategy that many of us in this room, of my age at least, a few this way, were told how to behave. I, on the other hand, thought, you know, this is kind of not so much fun. I love sailing. Thank you, Ralph. How do we really think about living in this digital, the early digital age is much more of one of playing with the winds. How do I use naturally occurring forces to play with the winds and so on? A lot easier than just plowing ahead. And what do? When you get blown off course too much, well, of course, you tack. Well, when I came to Silicon Valley, I learned we call that pivot. But it is kind of attack. I want to argue today is really qualitatively different. I want to claim that today's world in this networked age, this digital networked age, we'll come back to this, as opposed to just a digital age, a networked age, life has become much more like whitewater kayaking. Just to remind you what that's like, there may be some sound on that. This is an increasingly fast, radically contingent, and hyper-connected world that we're operating in. And that's one of the reasons why this new world is whitewater. And you will see, you get used to being thrown for loss, rolling, coming back, and so on and so forth. Not everything works. But here's the catch. What are we beginning to find? In this whitewater world, and if you are a whitewater kayaker, what really matters? What really matters is, do you know your own center of gravity? Is there a kind of authenticity so you can live in the moment? In whitewater kayaking, you do not have time to think. You must be. In order to know how to come out of a role, you don't want to think about it. You got to know who you are. You got to know your center of gravity. You got to know how to move and pull back and so on and so forth. So it's a sense of a different kind of authenticity, I want to argue, and a different sense of knowing self that may be required in this kind of whitewater age. I think this era also is no longer just about kind of deepening our individual expertises within our silos. This, by the way, becomes a fundamental challenge to most of the academy, because most of us in this room have been trained, coached, mentored in terms of how to really zero in on increasingly more narrow slots of incredible expertise. The sense of living in the silos is what most universities that I'm at seems to now have been reduced to. But perhaps many of us in this room, if not all of us, feel a little bit different. Maybe the real game is, how do we take seriously participating, much like in the kayaker, in shaping and participating in knowledge flows? You look at the person embedded in this infinite set of webs of networks. Most of us feel overwhelmed all the time. How do we keep located? How do we know how to start to interact and shape those flows? It is the ability to shape a flow that may actually have to do with the basis of agency and the basis of getting something done in this 21st century world. That sense of playing with the flow and rethinking agency in that context may be what we're really up to. And that's part of the reason why we've been thinking about this more in terms of the whitewater kayaking. There's a fairly deep kind of interplay between this. By the way, it also means that much of what we're doing as we participate in these flows is we're creating knowledge. And when you're creating knowledge in action in flow, many of us in this room know, most of what you do is tacit. If it's tacit, you haven't had time yet to crystallize it out. So in some sense, a new role of participation has to do with how do you, through participation, share tacit knowledge? Think about that. Most of the academy, most of the ways we build institutional architectures are not set up for that. The role of the tacit is becoming, I'm going to claim, increasingly more dominant in how we have to look at things. Let's step back a moment and think about the critical skills in this whitewater world. One of the most important things is skill in reading the currents, reading the kind of context, looking at the disturbances, and from those disturbances, looking a little bit of what is kind of the deep structure underlying the surface. What are the rocks? What's going on? What's causing those ripples to be like that? How do you read those ripples? You heard Paul Saffel talking about this in terms of a stacked architecture. How do we look at ripples up here and see what was maybe going on down here? What, by reading these flows and these ripples, what do they really reveal? But I think the other catch is, how do you leverage these currents and disturbances and flows for amplified action? So as a kind of a judo move, how do you work with the system to cause things to happen? But it's so easy to say that. Reading context is far from simple. We in the US and in Europe have already experienced our tremendous challenge in reading context. Almost no one saw Brexit. Almost no one saw the outcome of the current election in the US. Even those of us with infinitely powerful data visualization tools, deep learning algorithms, which I'm going to come back to, all these technologies actually didn't do much. I'm stunned that not a single data analyst with the best machine learning techniques, except one, who wants to remain secret, seems to have understood Brexit. In the US, we can argue that as well. So something is going on in terms of how do you read context. And guys, folks here, you know, our job is in some sense, through this technological lens that we have, we are expected to help people read context. But having said that, data analytics, which many of us worship, starting with me, can't do everything. Knowing what the right questions are is key. And understanding a profound separation between data, information, beliefs, and values. And if you ever have to work with an organization to get them to change a mindset, you want to think about how denial works, or think about how denial and beliefs and values start to interact, we're going to have to pay more attention to that than ever before. But I want to talk about this kind of disposition in this whitewater world of really being able to kind of constantly embed, do things, and learn from that. And it really struck me because I was asked to a little while ago to sit down and say, Ken John, what have you gone through in the last 15 years after you stepped down from running Xerox's Palo Alto Research Center? What have you had to discover for yourself? By the way, because I'm not part of a major institution, pretty much on my own. And let me list the things that everybody in this room, not everybody, but some of you in this room would think are almost second nature. You know, like all of a sudden I had to learn that two-phase commit was not the holy grail. Instead of two-phase commit, how do I work for eventual consistency? You want to know why does that matter? If you want to make Amazon Web Services fly, let me tell you, you better figure out eventual consistency instead of two-phase commit. How to remove from client server to cloud? I thought it was going to be simple. Let me tell you, if you try to take client server architectural principles up to the cloud, you're not going to do too well. You're not going to be able to exploit most of what the cloud is really capable of doing. For me, learning how to move from CPUs to CPUs plus GPUs was a huge game changer. suddenly you have to worry about the topology of where information lies. How do you really take mobile first seriously? We usually add mobile as an add-on, as a new layer on that stack, not understanding how the stack itself may have to be inverted. And there's no shock in this room, especially one of the tracks here, that security has now moved not just defensive to offensive moves. But I think more dramatic to me is those are the changes in the first 15 years for me personally speaking. This is what my life in the last year has been about in terms of now looking at not just GPUs, but how do I use the tensor processor units, et cetera, to really drive deep learning at speeds. How do deep learning machines really work? I'll come back to that. How does blockchain really work? What can you honestly do with it versus what you can't? How does this decentralized system honestly work? Needless to say, you know, we heard of the wonderful opening keynote from Todd. How does mixed reality systems work? We haven't gone into distributed drones here at all, but these are the kinds of things that turn out to have been kind of the dominant issues that those of us that kind of are in deeply in the MIT game and into institutional architectures, working with the government as well, have to think about. And having done all that, holy cows. And then the game for me and all of us in this room changed almost overnight. AlphaGo happened. I got a call, I think it was in February, telling me about how AlphaGo had beat the best Go champion in Switzerland. And what is my comment? Not being quite as, nowhere near as witty as Paul Saffel. I laughed and I said, give me a break. I think Switzerland only has 10 Go players. So I said, you know, it'll be years before you'll find that AlphaGo beats somebody from Korea or China. Well, it was exactly 6 weeks later that they took AlphaGo to China, and I think we all know the results of that. Maybe that really is, in some sense, a wake-up call. It should have been a wake-up call for me. Is it, in fact, not a wake-up call for all of us? Given all this, I think it's fair to say that this relentless pace of change and disruptions may suggest that incremental learning will no longer suffice. And that's what we are well trained to do. So part of this big shift is how do we move from a world of scalable efficiency to one of scalable learning. In that sense of participating in flows, generating new knowledge on the fly, et cetera, but we have to go beyond just scalable learning. I think this is the thing that most of us find almost impossible to do. How do you start to reframe? How do you accept becoming a newbie? Not just once, but almost every year becoming a newbie. That's the world that most of us have just walked into. Fair question. How do we think about doing this? I'm really struck by somebody I have had a great pleasure of accidentally meeting, Jack Hittery, who asked me, how often do you get out of your comfort zone? In fact, this is a question he asks all the CEOs he deals with. How often do you get out of your comfort zone? Perhaps getting out of your comfort zone is increasingly important in this global world of constant change. Maybe it is getting out of your comfort zone that really matters. But the question is, how do you get out of your comfort zone and learn anything? And the only reason I bring up Jack is because I ran into him at Aspen one day, and I said, Jack, what are you doing here? This is a conference on energy. You don't know anything about energy. And he said, he sat down next to me and said, John, let me tell you something. Every year, I choose some conference to go to that I know nothing about, but I want to learn. But I've invented a social protocol to to help me do this. The first day, I attend all the lectures. That was yesterday, from when I met him. And he said, the next day, what do? I don't go to the lectures. I hang out around the coffee. And I hang around the coffee in order to pick up the genres of communication in people in this particular community of practice. I learn how they talk to each other. I learn how they ask each other questions. It's a level of subtlety that a lot of us, as you drop into a brand new community, feel like, I'm not being heard. And then he said, the third day, I figured out enough about the content, I figured out enough about the interactional conversational patterns, that now I risk diving in and exposing my ignorance in conversation myself. That's how I do it. Interesting. Some of us know what happened as he left this conference. If you understand the hybrid taxi initiative in New York City, he went back, talked to Bloomberg. He's from New York. Talked to Bloomberg and convinced Bloomberg to initiate the hybrid taxi ruling. 2 months later, he went to Washington and got the Cash for Clunkers program through Congress. It's very interesting that just from those 3 days, through that social protocol, he grokked enough, he got enough understanding to be able to bring about a sense of agency to make those changes, leveraging the flows happening around him. Something very interesting there, I think. There's a whole sense of then how do you choose kind of the environments that help you do serendipity? What are the practices you want to develop? And then kind of how do you prepare to do that? And this slide, by the way, was not done around Jack. Some of you know that I study world champion surfers. And it's stunning to me how surfers do almost exactly what Jack does. They talk to the board shapers. They move into new areas. They're constantly moving around the world to pick up new things and so on and so forth. If you want to be the highest performing in some kind of thing like surfing, you do that. And I was so surprised to find out that this community, by the way, this community was around 18 to 19 year olds, had gotten this down completely on their own, did not have a language to articulate it, but this is the way they were operating. I want to suggest that there's a second technique that all of us in this room can actually do. We all know about the power of mentorship, but most of us don't think about reverse mentorship. How do we actually take seriously learning from people who've just come into our company, or the youngest people around, and so on and so forth? Because I think you'll find that reverse mentorship in today's age becomes as important as mentorship. And what are the practices that enable that to work? I say this because it was a very much of a kind of a personal eye-opener to me when I stepped down from Money Park in the year 2000. I wanted to pick up video game design, massively multiplayer games like World of Warcraft. And lo and behold, I had an opportunity to meet and approach J.C. Hertz, a 24-year-old kid, that I call her a kid, was the New York Times critic for games. And she listened to me. She said, you know a lot, John, but you really don't get it when it comes to my stuff. She said that on stage, unfortunately. And I approached her after that. And she said, well, why don't you come, if you want, and study under me for a year? You can fly to New York. And you just have to do everything I ask you to do. And I don't want any lip back from you, okay? And I said, that's a deal. And so for the next year, I did this, and through her, got to meet all kinds of people in the game community. One of my first assignments, it's very strange for me, to go to an art museum. She said, now take sketches, rate notes. I want to see what you saw in X, Y, and Z. So I felt like a little kid, just like you're talking, Eric. But it became interesting to me, again, the power of this kind of reverse mentorship. And going back to Kevin, this idea of the endless newbie is the new default, I think, for everyone, no matter what your age and your experience is. But the interesting thing is reverse mentorship is a powerful way to keep us humble, because it turns out to be amazing how much we learn from people that are often generations younger than ourselves. So let me move ahead to kind of looking at this thing more epistemologically. And by epistemologically, I mean not just knowing the what of something, but also understanding the how and the why. If you listened to Todd Richman talk on the first day, you saw a little bit of this coming into his talk and also up about how he approaches learning music as well. The what, the how, and the why. So we talked about how we move beyond incremental learning would no longer suffice. But we must now, I'm going to claim, be willing to regrind our conceptual lenses and regrind them often. Said most simply, living in exponential times in this global networked age that is densely interconnected or hyperconnected, if you want to talk about it that way, many of our problems today are wicked problems. Wicked problems have the interesting property that as soon as you touch them, they start to change. I'll come back to that. They are complex, not just complicated. And how to start understanding, dealing with a complex, non-stable problem. Just think about the Middle East, if you want a dramatic example of almost everything we do has unintended consequences, swamping the intended consequences. This is the world we're moving into. Said by Prahlad Khan, there is no special sphere of the environment, no distinct lands of oil, no detached global economy, no separate issues of public health. When we try to pick out anything by itself, we now find it attached to all kinds of other things. In fact, one of the diagrams that has driven both my colleague Ann and I a great deal is from the World Economic Forum, looking at the linkages involved in major crisis issues around the world. This is one that was designed in the Risk Landscape Report in 2014. And you begin to see how entangled everything becomes. Everything impacts everything else. This is a major new epistemological problem of how do you understand these types of entanglements in order to make progress. In fact, the classic notion of a wicked problem comes in Ritter and Weber, saying that as soon as you start to solve the problem, it morphs. In fact, I am fond of somebody says, I got a wicked problem, can you send me some engineers? And I said, I hate to tell you, but the worst thing you want to do is ever put an engineer on a wicked problem, because they're finding an optimal solution and the problem will have changed by the time they implement it. There's something else about playing with the problem space. We're coming back to playing in a moment. The catch-22 of wicked problems is that you cannot learn about the problem without trying solutions. But every solution you try has lasting, unintended consequences that are likely to spawn new wicked problems. Eric, I put that in for you. Examples of wicked problems include, of course, global warming, financial crisis, terrorism, which some of us here work a lot on, environmental design, homeless, and so on and so forth. Said very simply, we need new ways to move from mechanistic thinking to understanding the context, the problems that evolve out of sets of exchanges with complex feedback loops. Think dynamic attractors, think network affordances, think contextual propensities. That is our new game that we must play in. Think clouds, not clocks. As Karl Popper, the great philosopher, said, all problems are either clouds or clocks. One of the problems we have as a culture is that we take clouds and we pretend that they're clocks. To understand a clock, you can take it apart, look at its individual pieces, study the pieces, and then you can understand how the clock works. A cloud You can't take apart. A cloud is fundamentally a dynamic system. A cloud you can only study as a whole. This is one of the major epistemological challenges we're walking into. Perhaps this whitewater world may require, as Josh Cooper Ramwell has recently come out in his new book, a new sense, a seventh sense. We understand completely how we understand the current world through our six senses. Maybe we need a seventh sense that understands what does it mean to be embedded in the flows of those networks I was talking about earlier. The seventh sense, as he likes to say it, is the ability to look at any object and see the way it is changed by connection, let alone hyperconnection. Whether you're commanding an army, running a Fortune 500 company, planning a great work of art, or, by the way, thinking about your kids' education. These are all deeply interconnected problems today. And we want to argue that underlying this is, I'm going to say, we have a crisis of imagination. We need to see the way in which something and everything is changed by hyperconnectivity. How do we start to imagine those kinds of interconnections? Let's step back a moment. Is the power or the capacity of humans to form internal images of objects and situations, visual, auditory, motor, etc., the imagination does some amazing things for us. It closes the gap between what is novel and what is known. It finds connections between things that are not obvious. It plays with boundaries. It lets thoughts and partial thoughts jump fences. Engages in sense breaking as opposed to just sense making. And in seeing new possibilities, it helps us escape the tyranny of the present. We're operating where the tyranny of the present is the game we now play. Imagination, we want to argue, is not just an add-on. It's not just relevant within domains of the arts, humanities, but rather this cross-cuts the entire cognitive spectrum. So this suggests that we now may have to shift just from the epistemological issues we're talking about to look at this ontologically. How to construct these deeper understandings today. We need to develop new ways of being. And ontology is a way of being. Ontology, as opposed to epistemology, is a new way of knowing. I'm going to argue that we really now have something very fundamental here. And curiously, I think we can see this as a blend, a wonderful blend, between thinking about Homo sapien, man is knower, Homo faber, man is maker, and we all know in the education world and much of the science world, we can slip back and forth between those boundaries very easily. But we don't talk much about is Homo ludens, man is player. How, for example, you begin to understand the play of a system, for example. That's what really requires to kind of figure out how to do something new. And so we want to really say that this kind of almost new way of being is some blend of understanding this as a Homo ludens as much as Homo faber, whereas most of us are brought up thinking just Homo sapien was our challenge. All three play together, but the catch is the binding agent between these three things is the imagination. And we tend to think of imagination as just fancy stuff that artists deal with. I'm going to argue, no. Imagination is playing a very fundamental role in how we work with these three senses of Homo sapien, faber, and ludens. The imagination serves diverse cognitive processes across the entire cognitive activity space. That's the first principle of our book, Pragmatic Imagination. But I want to kind of come back to where we started, much of this whole HICSS 50th, the real moonshot of our time. How do we think about moving beyond text-planning, always taking a technological perspective to looking at these challenges, to understanding we must kind of understand a form of radical humanism in order to come to terms with the problems that we ourselves are creating with and for the world. The unique power of the human imagination comes in part from its ability to integrate opposing qualities like emotion and reason, curiosity and certainty. Man and machine, robot and so on. I'm really struck by this. I don't know how many of you know about freestyle chess. As you know, we can build chess machines that beat the world's best or even moderately good chess players and so on and so forth. What you may not realize is that if you take an average chess player, couple up with an average hacker that knows how to really get the computer on moderate computers, not super blue gene computers, to do things, and if these two moderate players learn how to deeply work with each other, game over. They beat every single world champion chess player and every chess machine. There is something about the magic of being able to combine the free imagination of one that doesn't have to worry about being correct and logical with the incredible computational power of the machine to check. We suggest maybe there's a new kind of marriage between man and machine we haven't talked much about that actually, with this simple proof case, is an eye-opener. But suppose we go back now and take that triangle I was talking about a moment, and now add AI to it, or in particular IA, intelligent augmentation tools. What we now have is something quite different. Because we now have ways to have specialized IAs increase Homo sapien, but the ways that those AI devices work are going to be completely different than the ways they're going to work over here. There'll be different deep learning systems, which again will be different than the deep learning systems over here. So somehow these three things, Homo ludens, Homo faber, Homo sapien, augmented in unique ways by IA, fused by imagination, start to produce things that are really quite unimaginable. But let me kind of wind down by saying we do have some serious questions. Here is an amazing quote by Chris, who headed up Google's self-driving car project for many years. "The infrastructures we build today will redefine mankind. The infrastructure we build over the next 5 years will redefine mankind." Now, it's a stunning assertion with a wonderful touch of melodrama. But is that melodrama real? Or is it actually something we need to realize probably could be true? I want to quickly build on what Peter Marx's talk, when he took you through the Google thing, and here was the car driving thing. This particular shot I'm working on here, I don't have my little pointer here, is it's trying to figure out that there's a bicycle up there, and it's trying to figure out the pattern of that bicyclist. We talked about that with Peter a little bit. This gets, of course, as you know, messier. But the catch is many things don't fit patterns. He stopped the film. This happened in Mountain View. Here is something that the Google system got profoundly confused on. What is it? It's a lady in a wheelchair crossing the road. Well, no, that's not unusual. Oh my God, this person is cycling around. Why is this person going in circles around that location? Well, if you look very, very, very carefully, it took me about 5 minutes to see it, new challenge in object recognition. She's chasing a duck. And the duck is running away from her. Now, that is something that's moderately hard to predict. So the point is, we're moving into building systems that you can't predict the patterns. This is the essence for complexity again. These are things that cannot be predicted. How do you really handle these things? And if you think about how deep learning works, you got to recognize that these machines are fantastic at capturing patterns. But so many people, even here, talk about, well, what are the algorithms, what are we programming into these machines? The catch with deep learning, unlike all the other systems that we build in terms of machine learning, basically the patterns emerge from being curated patterns of data. So in some interesting way, I've moved from being building systems to curating data. And here's the catch. How do we know that the data we are curating doesn't have implicit biases built into it in interesting ways? Because we don't even begin to know enough of the social theory about much of this world. And I'm really struck, sitting on various boards of directors, that it is a very interesting kind of compliance question we have. That more and more of our corporations are run by some of these black boxes. And it's not even if the algorithms are biased, it's the question, is the data bias going into these things? Let alone, what are the ethics? So I was really struck after looking at the Google car. Here's a cartoon that I just love to carry with me. Here's a psychoanalyst trying to figure out what's going on in that Google car. And in fact, I think it's kind of interesting to think about what are the compliance challenges we're actually facing in this kind of a world. Because these are the things that are driving our institutions. Let me show you a very concrete example. It's been talked about, I think, a little bit here already. Here's a case that a loan was denied. Now, why was this loan denied? Let me tell you. The data driving this machine learning came out of a world which, in essence, had come out of redlining. By the way, redlining is now a federal offense, but the data had still reflected it. This machine reinvented redlining. Now, is there any code in there that says redlining? No way. Is there any explicit way to see that in there? No. Very interesting question. What are the new forms of forensics that we now have to do on these systems in order to tell what this data had unintendedly ended up encoding in the behavior of the system? And I think our challenge now is to recognize we're not going to answer this by looking at the code. We're going to be answering this by looking at kind of much more of a social awareness of the data used to drive these systems. So let me suggest as we wind down here that there may be a blind spot in AI research. A social systems analysis is needed that draws on philosophy, law, sociology, anthropology, and science and technology studies, especially with respect to the curation of the data used to train these deep learning systems. Only by asking broader questions about the impacts of AI can we generate a more holistic and integrated understanding. We're not trained to think holistically, and yet we have created the very technologies that now demand that we have to be able to do that. Let me also suggest that many of these new infrastructural innovations exhibit an asymmetry developing between those developing the technologies and the creating the protocols and the gateways. Everybody else's future will be shaped by these gateways. How do we come to understand them? What are the new capabilities, the new conflicts, et cetera? And we already see Google and Facebook walking into this like a buzzsaw. So I want to kind of wind this down by suggesting, you know, these are the new infrastructures that are really disrupting the present and redefining our future. We can know all of these things. We have tracks on most of these things. But here is the real fact. These interact in ways, in unforeseeable way, mostly synergistically, amplifying the impact of each other in order to produce capabilities and results that are very, very hard to predict. So I want to suggest that maybe Chris's wild assertion, the infrastructures we build over the next 5 years will redefine mankind, is not so crazy after all. It has to do with unexpected synergies between that stack I just showed you. Thank you. So I think we're kind of late, so we can, do you want to have questions? Oh, we have 5 minutes for questions. And I'll be around after that, yeah. Of course, Eric, yes. No, no. And in fact, I think we can't hear each other. So let's just take this one question and then we'll talk in smaller groups. I mean, I think that what we're trying to do is get into the deep structure of what's going on. If we understand that deep structure, we'll be, I mean, going back to Paul Saffold's thing, if we look at the multiple layers, looking at the short and long-term variables, we're going to have a much better understanding of where is optimism warranted and what are the guardrails we should put up. Okay? But if you don't understand the stack that Paul talked about, which is phenomenal, we don't even begin to know how to prepare ourselves for the short versus long variables. Okay, thank you.